cho chọc
bao nhiêu cảm to cái tâm đa can để thì hay đối ông đại ông chúng ta mang chung đồng tam địa email đời trai chụp ảnh cho cô rồi bảo ông chụp đặt là tập bóng cao bên ngay tìm một phây pram khai một phây pram nâng một phây bay xong sam sắp khai cả nhà năm bị pon đập pram đi rồi hới cứ nô siêu rô siêu ní ông chụp đặt là tập bóng nâng phương sạm là cá sắp đập đây sơn than toàn mót rồi bảo phía kia từ lừa pành hà chụp nút bay tỉ mui số cái than là than rồi bảo phía kia từ lừa sầm nào sôm rồi bảo lúc mẹ đã vì trong mẹ vì nguồn chía để bàn thân là xong mọi ông chúng đất là tập bốn sẽ đập cái cắm bọn thêm chúng luôn bộ cô mới rút bẹp bọn nâng ông hết cả than cả nghe tùm lúc tập bèng thơm mó anh là lòng tam bị thiên bài sắp bẩm bẩm buôn này bị thiên giấy khăn ông và ai cái xa y bày rồi học sắp bẩm bấy thì bíc đây sẵn là than là bọc phía kỳ từ lư lịch khất là bọc สหปริญญาสหสืบเกตสหจักรามสืบเกตอันตรชีตในอวตกจุมวิญนิเตวิธีในการประพฤติขนมการสับสักไหกรรมในจุมเนียงได้มีหัสเนียมปีทีสีอีการสปรัมในจุปมกองจุนุญบยาสลาตบงไอกระซาอีใบเรหกสมเปิลสลาสมุยหนึ่งติใบกาดับบางไฮไอกระซาจุมนวลดับมุยปีตนมเรืองโซนโซนบุญมกนองตนมเรืองโซนโซนปีสละโซนปีดาวสหปริญญาอันตรชีตเปียปอนังอังไฮในการประพฤติเลือกกรมมนุษย์กูได้เจริญญาปูจุนจิตจามไอกระซาอีใบรอยดอกผมบุญสละสามใบไอหนึ่งปัญหาจงกร้อยคือเมียนสดับในสำนาสมรบสหมิตรวีกาปิกระไดโลกเขียนสมพรเปียปอนังปัญหามวยจำนวนปัจเจตบงนี้อังยมเรียยกปัญหาติมุยมอกไปพิษาให้ตะบงนี้องยมเดชสมสัวเธอพิกีธาตาพิกีเมียนบำนองฉลายตอบจนหนึ่งสำนักส้มหรือเปล่ามีตะวีกาไปใดนวลจีไรตีหรือปัญหานี้ให้ตะบงนี้ดำไปเอาเมียนกาฉบับรอประธานชิดองยมเดชสมประกุลวิติกาจุนเตอร์ธาเมตุบีกาไปกระไดนุนชี้นำไปบังหายได้สังเข็บในสำนาสมนังมุลเฮในการสำนาสมเอาองค์ยมเรียดับสักไหกรรมสักใสมวยรูปเปียปอนจะมวยนังเปียมวยรูปบรรทายมิตรเปียปอนนังองค์เฮการทานการงี้ตุ่มรูปตัวเปียงทม
Thank you, Mr. President. I don't think I have actually that much to add to our request. I think it is argued why this particular witness is necessary to hear in relation to Chua Ping Tumandang. I think he can potentially provide very interesting evidence as to structures, etc. at the dam, but of course also in relation to possible events in the Northwest Zone in more general terms. We know that we have confronted certain witnesses already with his testimony. So I think this particular witness is an important witness and should come to the courtroom to testify. So I think all our arguments are in here, so I have nothing really to add specifically.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President. I think I can be very brief. The prosecution does not oppose the defense request to hear this additional witness, given the fact that his WRI and his DCPM statement are both already before the chamber, and given the fact that they've been used with a number of witnesses, we think it's a reasonable request. We think that the perhaps the defense's primary point is the witness's evidence regarding what they would characterize as a planned rebellion. In our submission, the written evidence that's now before the chamber is ambiguous and incomplete in that regard. And for that reason, we submit that it would be reasonable to call the additional witness. I would just add that we don't agree with the defense's characterization of his evidence on the conditions at the dam as being exculpatory. We would submit that the excerpts of his evidence they've selected are very narrow and don't accurately portray the whole of his evidence, and that his evidence regarding the conditions will ultimately be inculpatory. But I also believe that's a conversation that we can have at another time. So, in short, Your Honor, we don't oppose the defense's motion.
Non, Monsieur le Président, nous en rapportons la sagesse de la Chambre.
បញ្ហាទី2យើងមកវិភាក្សាគឺពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងខ្លឹមសារនៃលិខិតរបស់សហជក្រមសើបអង្កេតអន្តរជាតិមុននឹងសម្រេចថាតើការដំណើរការសហការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញដែលមានហត្ថលេខាទី TC2កៅសប្រាំត្រូវប្រព្រឹត្តទៅដោយម្តេចនោះអង្គជំរះមានបំណងស្ដាប់នៅមតិយោបល់របស់ភាគីជាមុនសិនហើយដបងនេះស្ដាប់នៅមតិយោបល់របស់
Thank you, Your Honors. Good afternoon to everyone. Your Honor, the co-prosecutors have read the letter from the international co-investigating judge. We believe his request to have a legal officer present is reasonable. We understand that investigations are confidential, not by his discretionary decision, but by law at the ECCC. I would say, though, that I don't anticipate that there should be a great problem with any disclosures of confidential information. I do not, the prosecution does not plan to ask the expert about what people said to OCIJ. Those records of interview are on the case file already developed once, and they speak for themselves. We will be asking the expert questions regarding the chan and what happened to them based on his work. He has written two books. He clearly has made many, many, many interviews outside of his work for the OCIJ. But I do think it's reasonable, the concern of the international co-investigating judge, and because his concerns are reasonable, it would be advantageous, I believe, but up to Your Honors, to have a legal officer from that chamber present to bring to Your Honor's attention any concerns they have about disclosing confidential information.
Thank you, Your Honor. មានមតិយោបល់អ្វីដែរទេលើខ្លឹមសារនៃលិខិតរបស់ចក្រមសហចក្រមសើបអង្កេតអន្តរជាតិនេះ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Pas d'observation particulière à la lettre que nous avons lue et nous nous en référons à la sagesse de la Chambre sur ce point. Nous nous adapterons.
អរគុណចុះក្រុមសហមន្ត្រីការពារក្តីលោកលោកនួនជាមានមតិយោបល់អ្វីដែរទេលើខ្លឹមសារនៃលិខិតរបស់សហជក្រមសើបអង្កេតអន្តរជាតិពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មអ្នកជំនាញពី TCE 95នាពេលខាងមុខពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងសំណុំរឿង 0304
yes, thank you, Mr. President. We're not convinced yet that it is quite as simple as the prosecution is describing. Let me first say, of course, there are confidentiality issues in case four. There's no dispute or discussion, I think, there. However, Mr. Osman is primarily here to come to testify as an expert. That is a personal obligation of him to the court. It's up to him, first of all, to decide whether he, when answering any questions, is violating certain procedural rules or certain confidentiality issues in the investigation. So I think all parties should be able to ask all the questions they would like to ask. It is then up to Mr. Osman to decide whether answering any such question would bring him into problems. And then it's up to you to decide whether he, in a particular instance, can indeed decline to answer. So it is there that potential problems might arise, obviously not in the questions that we are asking. Let me give you an example. Obviously, in our case, in this trial, we're talking about events at Wat Othakun, the pagoda. We all know that this particular pagoda is part of the investigation of case four. If I would ask him in general terms about what he knows of, for instance, the command structure at Wat Othakun, he would potentially get into problems because this very same topic is being investigated right now. In theory, it might not seem problematic, but in practice, we could enter quickly a situation where there's all kinds of debates coming as to whether his answers are bound by a rule or ruled by confidentiality restrictions or not. So, the problem is that we are both dealing with the same investigations, or at least partially, that are being done in case four. I think that should be resolved per question, but I'm not quite sure how, in this very simple example, things would go, because strictly speaking, he could answer, I cannot say anything about that, because technically he would be right, because that is part of case four. But if it's such a broad formulation, then it will possibly end up in him not giving any answers, for instance, about what happened in Sector 41, or more particularly in Wat Othakun. In respect of the question whether someone should be sitting next to him, that is, I think, also not without problems. I think there is some comparable case law at the ICTY, in which, in the appeal proceedings, I think it was in the Milosevic case, where two government officials were present in the courtroom while a witness was while a witness was answering questions. The appeals chamber ruled that although there was no provision to do this, the trial chamber at the time was allowed to have government officials in the courtroom. But I don't think these government officials were allowed to intervene with a particular witness. They couldn't coach him, or they couldn't say that one question or the other question could be answered yes or no. Having said that, the question then arises whether Ms. Ewing, who is, I understand, a legal officer, is the one who should be entitled to be present and possibly to assist the expert. In my own jurisdiction, that would be typically a lawyer representing the witness who could advise the witness whether certain questions should be answered yes or no. I don't think, or maybe that is the case, but I'd be happy to hear that, whether Mrs. Ewing is in fact admitted to the Cambodian bar and allowed to advise the expert. I think that is something that we should find out, and the expert is sitting here at his personal title, and therefore I think if assisted by someone in the courtroom, it should be a lawyer allowed to practice in the courts of Cambodia. So, I think in theory it might not be problematic, but in practice it could be problematic. So I think we should have a debate on how exactly we should proceed with the expert, especially when it comes to issues in relation to Sector 41 or Wat'ot-Rukut. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Pour la défense de Khieu Samphan, en fait, il y a deux questions qui se posent. Nous comprenons bien le caractère confidentiel des instructions en cours, et en même temps, si l'expert de TCE 95 a été appelé par la Chambre en tant qu'expert, c'est qu'on estime qu'il a des informations utiles pour des faits qui concernent les faits objets des débats devant la Chambre et qui, pour Monsieur Khieu Samphan en tant qu'accusé doivent pouvoir être débattus de façon publique sans qu'il y ait de huis clos, le huis clos n'étant que quelque chose de particulièrement exceptionnel. Sur les interviews, les entretiens de cet expert avec un certain nombre de témoins qui ont déposé devant cette chambre, je pense qu'il n'y a pas de difficulté puisqu'ils font effectivement partie du dossier. Sur les réponses à d'autres questions comme celle que vient d'évoquer mon confrère de façon plus générale, l'expert, s'il est expert et si on considère comme ayant un niveau d'expert, doit pouvoir seul, sans l'assistance de qui que ce soit, pouvoir déterminer ce qu'il est en mesure de dire ou de ne pas dire. Nous ne faisons pas référence à un témoin lambda. Si la Chambre a estimé nécessaire de l'appeler en tant qu'expert, et je rappelle ce sujet que la défense de Khieu Samphan, anticipant ses problèmes, ne souhaitait pas qu'il comparaisse comme expert, mais enfin, la décision de la Chambre a été prise dans ces conditions. Il faut faut le traiter comme n'importe quel expert et faire en sorte qu'il puisse, de façon indépendante, répondre sans que nous ayons besoin de lui tenir la main, répondre aux questions en faisant bien évidemment application de ses obligations de confidentialité s'il en a. Je pense que si il a effectivement ce niveau d'expert, il n'a pas besoin que quelqu'un l'assiste. Que une personne du bureau des coaches d'instruction soit dans la salle pour pouvoir suivre pleinement les débats, il n'y a pas de souci, mais que cette personne puisse intervenir et suggérer à l'expert de répondre dans tel ou tel sens qui ne semble pas adéquat dans un débat judiciaire. Donc ça, c'est la position de la défense de Pio Sampan. S'il vient en tant qu'expert, qu'il témoigne en tant qu'expert en répondant au mieux de ses possibilités des informations qu'il a, dans le respect, évidemment, on ne demande pas de violer ses obligations professionnelles dans le respect de ses obligations professionnelles. Voilà sur la question de la manière dont nous envisageons l'audience, étant précisé qu'en tout état de cause, nous, ce qui nous intéresse, c'est ce qui figure au dossier 02-2, ce qui concerne les faits pour lesquels M. Pio Sampan a été renvoyé devant cette chambre, et en l'espérant avec un minimum d'entrée d'éléments de preuve qui sont en cours d'investigation et qui ne sont a priori pas l'objet de la présence de M. Pio Sampan devant cette chambre, puisqu'il a été renvoyé sur non pas des éléments de 004 ni de 003, mais des éléments dans le dossier pour lequel il a été parti à l'instruction. Ça, c'est les observations que nous avons à faire sur ce point. Nous avons d'autres observations à faire sur l'expert. Je ne sais pas si M. le Président, vous souhaitez que je les fasse maintenant de façon à ce que les parties puissent répondre sur le tout, ou si vous souhaitez d'abord poser des questions éventuellement sur cet aspect.
I just want to make one comment. I don't expect the parties here to answer this question, but for me, frankly, it's not completely clear. If one reads the request, point A, it would appear that the investigating judge says he cannot be asked any questions gathered during O4 investigation under any circumstances. So, no matter whether it's closed or open session, completely closed. While if one reads the paragraph above, it appears to indicate that it might be possible to ask him these questions in closed session, because it says if this will take place in open court, he will not be at liberty to disclose. So, I think we might have to clarify, actually, what that means. Does he want to preclude any information under any circumstances that he considers confidential, or would he agree to such information being given in closed court?
Yeah. I believe it's my understanding of the letter that the defense seems to be misconstruing what Judge Bolander is asking the legal officer to do. It is not to represent Issa Osman, the witness. It is to represent his office in making sure that confidential information from that investigation is not disclosed. Counsel's indicated that some complex issues could arise from his questioning about what can and cannot be disclosed. I don't believe the witness is a lawyer himself, and the judge in charge of the investigation is asked to have a lawyer from his office represent his office, not the witness. Clearly, it would be improper for any legal officer representing the judge to tell the witness how to answer a question. That would be wrong, not to give them information about how to answer, but she should be allowed to advise the court Your Honors about what types of questions would lead to violations of the confidentiality required in those investigations, or to confer, I believe, with the witness to determine if his answer would reveal confidential information, and then instruct him whether, or tell Your Honors whether or not he is permitted to give that answer. But again, he's not representing, or the legal officer would not be representing the witness, they're representing the office of the co-investigating judge.
If I may respond quickly, Mr. President, in this courtroom in case 002, the international co-investigating judge has no status. He is no party. He is someone, of course, that we're dealing with because of the statements that he's disclosing to us. But as such, his office has no standing in this courtroom. Following from that, any legal officer from his office has no status in this courtroom. Only lawyers, like for instance lawyers advising witnesses not to answer questions if that could incriminate themselves, the witnesses. These parties or functionaries who actually have proper standing in this court. A legal officer representing an organ which doesn't have any standing in this court, I don't think is a proper way of proceeding. If I read the letter from the international co-investigating judge, it says, should any questions arise regarding the proper scope of his testimony, this will permit him, the expert, to consult her, the legal officer, in the presence of the trial chamber and the parties. So, not being his lawyer, would cause a very unusual situation, I think. The representative or the office itself have no proper standing in case 002. So that's why I think we should be very precise in this respect. And if you were to decide that a legal officer has a functioning or can function in this court, we should be very clear as to what her position is. So I do think it is problematic.
Juste une précision pour indiquer que la défense de Que Sampan, outre les observations que j'ai évoquées, rappelle que la décision de la Chambre E319-7 sur la manière d'utiliser des documents venant d'une instruction en cours serait également appliquée par les parties. Je ne sais pas si je peux rentrer dans le détail en audience publique de la manière dont nous devons procéder, mais enfin il y avait déjà une procédure mise en place par la Chambre pour les documents relatifs à des instructions en cours. Donc les mêmes mesures, je suppose, seraient également applicables dans le cadre des questions posées à l'expert.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Juste une courte observation. Je pense que
ខ្ញុំយល់ពីការប្រឹងប្រែងដើម្បីទប់ស្កាត់នៅការសម្ងាត់នៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងផ្សេងក្រៅពីសំណុំរឿង 002 ដែលយើងកំពុងធ្វើសកម្មភាពនេះ ខ្ញុំបាទក៏ដូចជួនចប់ចោលនៅក្នុងទីនេះនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងវាមិនអាចឲ្យយើងត្រូវគោរពនៅកតបកិច្ចណាមួយតេតតងទៅនឹងការសម្ងាត់ដែលមាននៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងផ្សេងដែលធ្វើឲ្យប៉ះពាល់ឬក៏ដែលមានប្រយោជន៍ផ្ទុយពីសិទ្ធិរបស់កូនក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំនៅទីនេះបានទេពីព្រោះយើងត្រូវការពារផលប្រយោជន៍កូនក្តីនៅទីនេះអញ្ចឹងបើសិនជាមានវិវាទដែលសហជាក្រុមស៊ើបអង្កេតលើកឡើង ហាមឃាត់មិនអោយតាំងសំណួរណាមួយដែលនាំអោយប៉ះពាល់ដល់សិទ្ធិរបស់កូនក្តីនោះវាធ្វើអោយការការពាររបស់យើងនៅទីនេះគឺគ្មានប្រសិទ្ធភាពណាដូច្នេះវាមិនមានច្បាប់ណាមួយដែលហាមឃាត់ថាជួនចប់ចោលត្រូវតែលះបង់កតបកិច្ចការពារសិទ្ធិរបស់ខ្លួនដើម្បីផលប្រយោជន៍នៃការរក្សាការសម្ងាត់ណាមួយនេះទេបាទសូមអរគុណ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. La règle qui me paraît importante ici, c'est la règle 56 du règlement intérieur, qui dit que l'instruction est secrète, mais que toute personne y participant est tenue à la confidentialité. Donc, il s'agit d'une obligation personnelle qui incombe à chaque personne participant à l'instruction de ne pas révéler des obligations, des informations qui sont confidentielles. Donc, je suis pour le coup d'accord avec nos confrères de la défense pour dire qu'il appartient à Issa Ousmane de savoir quelles sont les informations qui rentrent dans le champ de son obligation de confidentialité et celles qu'il ne peut pas révéler. Donc pour moi, deux solutions s'offrent à la Chambre. Soit Issa Ousmane est assisté d'un conseil qui peut le conseiller sur l'étendue de son obligation de confidentialité au regard de son contrat avec OCIJ. Soit vous décidez d'avoir le legal officer qui est proposé par les co-juges d'instruction qui viendrait, quant à elle, représenter les intérêts du bureau des co-juges d'instruction. Mais quant à M. Issa Ousmane, il est tenu par une obligation de confidentialité. Cette obligation, elle lui est personnelle. Et c'est à lui qui incombe de définir les paramètres de son obligation de confidentialité.
Your Honor, I just wanted to point out that what counsel said earlier is correct. There is some precedent of lawyers for outside organizations representing a witness, not the witness, excuse me, but representing, in this case, governments. I think counsel mentioned the Milosevic case. In these other tribunals, they have rules regarding national interests, that information that can compromise national interests can be provided to the court under certain circumstances and kept confidential. So in the Milosevic case, Wesley Clark, a general from the United States, Ambassador Orkin, U.S. Ambassador, testified with U.S. government representatives present to argue about the applicability of that rule, Rule 70, to limit his testimony. Also, in the more recent case, in Stanisic case, the UK ambassador, I believe his name is Roberts, testified, and representatives of the government of the United Kingdom did not represent him. They represented his government in saying what information would be confidential that he could not be asked about or could not disclose. So it's exactly the same situation in this case. To ask the witness, a non-lawyer, to make those determinations, I think would be very unfair to him and to the office of co-investigating judges. Especially since we've heard from defense counsel just now that they anticipate that they may ask about confidential information and disclose it because it's in the interest of their client.
Oui, ceci est une simple réaction à ce que je viens d'entendre de la part de la co-avocate principale pour les parties civiles, en disant qu'il y a deux options, soit il est assisté d'un avocat, soit il y a la présence de quelqu'un représentant le bureau des co-juridictions. Je ne vois pas tellement quel serait l'intérêt d'avoir un avocat présent dans la salle pour conseiller M. Ismaël Haussmann, dans la mesure où cet avocat n'est pas un avocat d'une partie impliquée dans l'instruction, donc il ne peut pas avoir accès au dossier de l'instruction. On ne voit pas très bien comment il pourrait discuter des problèmes de confidentialité susceptibles de se poser. À moins que j'ai mal compris quelque chose, peut-être clarifier cette proposition,
Je vous écoute, Monsieur le juge, et je me rends compte effectivement que ce n'était pas une bonne solution, mais je voulais simplement rappeler à la Chambre que c'est une obligation de confidentialité qui est personnelle et que, en premier lieu et avant tout, il appartiendra à l'expert de déterminer si les informations et les questions qui lui sont posées amèneraient à partager avec nous des informations qu'il considère comme confidentielles.
One brief point, if you allow me, Mr. President, I would like to make. Both the civil party lawyer and Judge Lavergne are speaking of the Office of the Co-Investigating Judges. I don't think that is properly formulated. It is a request of only the international co-investigating judge. And you might think, well, does that matter? Well, possibly it might matter, especially in the light of a very recent decision, a decision that was released on last Friday in the case of Mia's Mut urgent request for a stay of execution of his arrest warrant. There's a very interesting paragraph in the opinion of the three national judges. Mia's Mut had asked to ask for a stay of the execution of the arrest warrant and had asked that to the pretrial chamber, and the pretrial chamber national judges said the following thing, and that's very interesting. The arrest warrant is a coercive measure to be enforced by judicial police to bring Mia's Mut before the international co-investigating judge alone, but not before both co-investigating judges. This measure in Cambodian society is regarded as humiliating and affecting Mia's Mut's honor, dignity, and rights substantially and irremediably. Now,
លោកអាចនិយាយបានទេលោកលើកចំណុចនេះមកពេលនេះពិភាក្សារឿងទៅនីតិវិធីនៃការស្ដាប់ចម្លើយសក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញហើយនិងដែលមានវត្តមានមន្ត្រីច្បាប់មកពីការិយាល័យរដ្ឋក្រមព្រំកេតនោះវាមានតេតិនអីជាមួយនឹងឯកសារ
I was getting to my point, Mr. President. It seems that the pre-trial judges, the national pre-trial judges, are making a distinction if a measure, coercive measure, or anything is coming from only the international co-investigating judges rather than from both. Now, the reason I was standing up is that we are talking about a letter or request from only the international co-investigating judges. And if that is the case, it seems that national judges should react differently, possibly, to such requests. So I'm just making the observation that we're speaking about the Office of the Co-Investigating Judges. That's not accurate. We're speaking about a request only of the International Co-Investigating Judge. And a similar request from an International Co-Investigating Judge was met by the national judges in case 4 as something, affecting the accused's right substantially and irremediably. So I think we should also maybe hear from the national prosecutor what the position is in relation to this request in respect of the expert only coming from the Office of the International
Coordination.
លោកអញ្ចឹងចង់ដឹងទេលោកបើចាកុពេតើលោកចង់និយាយថាម៉េចឥឡូវចង់និយាយថាសំណើសុំនេះគឺมันមានសុពលភាពมันអាចយកមកពិចារណាភាសានេះបានព្រោះយើងភាសានេះយើងគិតថាវាទទួលហើយបានន័យថាវាទៅលើខ្លឹមសារទេមិនមែនទៅលើទម្រង់ទេហើយបើសិនជាយើងមិនទទួលលោកចង់លើកឡើងបញ្ហាអញ្ចឹងថាបើទទួលទៅវាខុសនឹងនីតិវិធីវាគ្មានសុពលភាពឬក៏បដិសេធ
Well, it is our position when it comes to the request to summons 3 witnesses. We, last week, we filed our response and we argued that the request from the international co-prosecutor was null and void and could not be entertained by the trial judge. So it is our position in relation to that particular request. It will be our position in relation to the pending requests for disclosure and adding into evidence of certain case 4 disclosures. If it's our position here, I'm not entirely sure yet because the decision is a bit ambiguous. But I think we can all agree that there is a problem, a legal problem, if there's only international co-investigating judge asking this, and his national counterpart is completely silent. So I think it is a problem, yes.
I would just point out that the national co-investigating judge has consistently stressed the confidentiality of the investigation. បាទហើយតទៅបញ្ហាមួយទៀតគឺបញ្ហាទី3ហើយដើម្បីឲ្យអង្គជំនះនឹងមានមូលដ្ឋានសមត្របក្នុងការរៀបចំកាលវិភាកសម្មនការជាពិសេសសម្មនការនៃការស្ដាប់សក្តិកម្មអ្នកជំនាញពី TCE គឺសប្រាំនេះពេលខាងមុខអង្គជំនះសូមសួរទៅសហប្រញ្ញាអន្តរជាតិថាតើសហប្រញ្ញាមានបំណងដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារបន្ថែមទៀតក្រៅពីឯកសារចំនួន
27 records of interview that are in Khmer only that we are in the process of having reviewed
with the limited staff that we have that can review those in Khmer. So I don't know whether or not they will be the subject of a disclosure motion or not. There also are three requests currently pending before the Office of the Co-Investigating Judges for disclosure of a few civil party applications, and we're waiting. I would expect decisions soon, but we're awaiting those. But those are only civil party applications, not records of interview. And I would stress that we've taken to heart what Your Honor said about the prosecution being very limiting, being using our discretion to be only request only the most critical civil party applications for admission under 87.4. But these are being reviewed also for whether or not, of course, there's any exculpatory information. There still are, from my understanding today, about 400 applications, victim applications, civil party applications, that have not yet been reviewed, and those we would also review under the same criteria. Now, this is unless the defense is saying, and Your Honors wish us not to review those. If everyone doesn't want us to review those, I'm happy not to do that. It's a lot of work for us. But the current plan is to fulfill our obligations to the defense in the chamber and to continue to review those last 400 applications. We've reviewed about 1,300 applications already.
Can I just ask a supplementary question? I believe you mentioned 27 are currently under consideration. Is that correct?
There are 27 that are not in English. Yeah. They're in Khmer, and they're in the process of, which is much slower of having those reviewed.
So, can you give me any indication as to if any of those will be disclosed, when this will be?
And
obviously they need to be translated because only in Khmer.
So it would take some time. I don't know the answer to that really. I'd be just guessing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. President. One remark. Documents that were disclosed yesterday contains a WRI of a witness considered to be very important, maybe the most important one. This witness was only interviewed a few weeks ago, a month ago. This means that the investigation is ongoing as we speak. This means that it will not stop, obviously, with those 27 or 7 from yesterday, but it will continue. I think that is the crux of the problem. It will go on. Even now, as we speak.
Just for the record, of course, that is correct. The investigation goes on, so we continue to have them come in, these records of interview. I would say that we were behind, and we pretty much caught up to the backlog. So now we're dealing only with them as they come in, so it'll be much faster
turnaround.
À ce stade, Monsieur le Président, j'interviens évidemment pour dire que nous attendons du côté de la défense de Khmer Sampan avec impatience la réponse à notre requête. Peut-être qu'il y aura des limitations qui seraient utiles à l'accélération de ce procès, puisqu'encore une fois, je note que souvent, dans la presse, c'est souvent repris d'ailleurs, que on accorde des délais à la défense pour examiner de nouveaux documents. C'est important de souligner que ce n'est pas des délais qui sont demandés inutilement, mais qui sont demandés uniquement par la communication de nouveaux documents. Donc, c'est important de le dire. En ce qui concerne les deux récentes communications par l'éco-procureur, celle d'aujourd'hui ou d'hier, je ne sais plus, nous n'avons toujours pas accès. Enfin, en tout cas, il y a quelques minutes, nous n'avions pas accès à ces nouveaux documents. Donc, il y a une requête qui a été déposée en communication de documents, mais nous n'avons pas encore accès à ces documents-là. Il y a aussi ces questions de délai de mise à disposition qui s'ajoutent aux problèmes déjà évoqués. Donc, vraiment, nous attendons vivement votre décision pour voir si ça ne peut pas limiter le flux de ces informations. Encore une fois, l'instruction 004 et l'instruction 003 ne sont pas des instructions dans lesquelles M. Khmer Sampan est parti.
បាទអរគុណហើយជាចុងក្រោយខ្ញុំប្រាប់វិទ្យការជូនទៅក្រុមសហមេតិវិការពីក្តីខឿនសំផនដើម្បីបង្ហាញនៅសំណើសុំរបស់ខ្លួនដែលបានអង្គការបានទទួលតាមអ៊ីមែលកាលពីថ្ងៃមិញហើយសូមបង្ហាញតែពីនេះតែម្ដងទៅតែមានបំណងធ្វើយ៉ាងដូចម្ដេច
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je vais commencer d'abord par le point qui concerne l'expert dont nous avons évoqué la comparution tout à l'heure. Je pense que ma première demande est extrêmement logique. Dans le cadre de votre premier calendrier, vous aviez programmé cet expert en fin de segment après l'audition de toutes les personnes ayant trait au segment du traitement des CHAM. Pour des raisons diverses et variées, qui ne sont évidemment pas du fait de la Chambre, mais qui sont des problèmes de programmation, un certain nombre de témoins qui devaient comparaître n'ont pas pu comparaître aux périodes anticipées. Je crois comprendre que ces témoins vont être appelés à une date ultérieure. Donc ma première demande est évidemment de faire en sorte que l'expert puisse toujours témoigner après la comparution de ces témoins-là, puisque un certain nombre de ces témoins ont été entendus par lui. Et que dans le cadre de notre interrogatoire, nous avons l'intention de revenir sur ces entretiens, évidemment ce qui aura été dit à la barre par ces témoins, et qu'en conséquence, il est plus logique que cet expert comparaisse après la comparution de tous les témoins sur le segment. Ça, c'est un premier point. Le deuxième point, qui est en lien avec le premier, à savoir que nous avons au fil des audiences constaté qu'il y a un certain nombre de documents que nous aimerions pouvoir soumettre à l'expert, des parties que nous voudrions pouvoir lui faire commenter, et que compte tenu de ce qui se passe à l'audience, lorsqu'on doit donner des ERN, lorsqu'on doit donner lecture de certaines parties, que ça prend du temps, nous anticipons du côté de la défense de Kyo Saipan que les deux jours qui avaient été initialement prévus par la Chambre, qui correspondraient pour l'équipe de Kyo Saipan à une demi-journée d'interrogatoire, c'est-à-dire 2h20 à peu près, serait certainement trop courte pour permettre la revue dans un délai raisonnable des différents documents et différentes déclarations et différents points que nous aimerions aborder avec l'expert. Et donc nous souhaitons, pour que ça ne soit pas comme souvent la course en dernière minute et de demander des minutes supplémentaires. Nous voudrions demander à la Chambre d'envisager au moins une session supplémentaire de plus par partie. Je ne sais pas, je parle pour la défense de Kyo Saipan. Je ne sais pas si c'est la même chose pour les autres parties, mais en tout état de cause, uniquement pour le caractère pratique de l'organisation de l'interrogatoire, la demi-journée pour l'équipe de Kyo Saipan paraît un peu courte si on veut un interrogatoire qui soit quand même audible et compréhensible par tous. Voilà, sur ce thème précis, ce que la défense de Kyo Saipan avait à dire. Je ne sais pas si vous souhaitez d'abord donner la parole aux autres parties ou si vous avez des questions particulière sur ce point avant que j'aborde l'autre requête, en tout cas l'autre point que j'ai évoqué dans mon email. La deuxième requête est peut-être prématurée, mais qui est en réponse à la question que je n'avais pas bien comprise d'ailleurs lorsqu'elle avait été posée par Madame le juge Fence il y a quelques jours en audience, à savoir de combien de temps la défense aurait besoin pour préparer les audiences d'appel, puisque c'était, si je comprends bien, une préoccupation de la Chambre dans le cadre de la détermination de son calendrier. Nous n'avons pas encore d'ordonnance fixant les audiences devant la Cour suprême. Nous anticipons, selon les échanges officieux, que des audiences de plaidoirie devraient intervenir, c'est sûr, avant la fin de l'année, quelque part mi-novembre, peut-être entre mi-novembre, enfin il y a une fourchette entre mi-novembre, fin novembre et peut-être éventuellement début décembre, je ne sais pas, puisqu'il y a aussi une semaine avec des jours fériés. Donc nous ne savons pas exactement quand ces audiences auront lieu, mais nous avons une fourchette en tout cas d'une dizaine de jours, et nous avons calculé en fonction du travail qui a effectué que nous aurions besoin au niveau des avocats de la défense, qui sont ceux qui vont plaider, nous aurions besoin de 5 semaines sans audience pour préparer ces audiences de plaidoirie qui, comme vous le savez peut-être, seront non seulement le moment d'exposer nos points d'appel, mais également le seul moment où nous pourrons répliquer à la réponse des autres parties, puisqu'il n'y a pas de réplique écrite qui a été prévue par la Cour suprême. Donc il y a un travail important qui sera à faire sur ce point. Par ailleurs, il y a aussi une possibilité, il y a eu des témoins nouveaux qui ont été entendus, et ces éléments nouveaux seront également débattus oralement. Et il y a une possibilité, nous ne savons pas encore, d'éventuellement, dans le cadre de cette programmation de plaidoirie devant la Cour suprême, une peut-être possibilité d'audition d'autres témoins. Donc ça aussi, c'est un élément à prendre en préparation. Donc nous avons calculé, puisque nous ne pouvons pas être à la fois au four et au moulin, c'est-à-dire à la fois être à l'audience devant cette chambre et à la fois en train de préparer ces importantes plaidoiries. Et quand je dis importantes plaidoiries, vous l'aurez compris, nous savons que c'est la dernière ligne droite avant une décision qui aura un impact sur le procès 02/2. Et c'est important, je pense, pour l'ensemble des parties, mais particulièrement pour la défense. Donc voilà les éléments que je peux vous donner à ce stade. Je ne sais pas du tout, encore une fois, quelle sera la date retenue par la Cour suprême, mais en termes de durée de travail sur ce que nous avons à faire, 5 semaines à temps plein pour les co-avocats sont nécessaires.
ដែលក្រុងផ្ដាល់ទៅឲ្យនឹងទៅលើអ្នកជំនាញពីTCE 95ហ្នឹងគឺវាទៅឡងខ្លីពេកហើយបើការដែលលោកស្រីប្រមាល់មើលថាសំរុំហ្នឹងលោកស្រីស្នើសុំឲ្យប្រមាណទៅពួកបញ្ហានេះកាលណាយើងផ្ដាល់ឲ្យភាគីមួយគឺបានតែភាគីទាំងអស់ត្រូវទទួលបានពីអត្ថប្រយោជន៍នៃការពន្យារពេលនេះវាប្រហែលគ្នា
Oui, effectivement, là pour le coup, je ne demandais pas, c'est pour ça que je fais la demande en amont, c'était que pour éventuellement toutes les parties puissent en bénéficier. Pour moi, un minimum de 3 sessions serait nécessaire pour l'interrogatoire de l'expert. Donc, au lieu d'avoir une demi-journée, d'avoir 3 sessions, voilà, au lieu d'en avoir 2, d'en avoir 3.
បាទអរគុណហើយចុះមេធាវីខៀវសំផនគឺមេធាវីនួនជាតើមានពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងបញ្ហាចុងក្រោយដែលលើកឡើងដោយថាមេធាវីកាអានេះមេធាវីកាពេលក្តីខៀវសំផនបាញ់មិញនេះលើការសុំរយៈពេលប្រាំសប្តាហ៍ដើម្បីត្រៀមរៀបចំនៅសារណាទល់មាត់សម្រាប់ធ្វើការលើបញ្ចប់ឬលើបដិងសាទុក
Thank you, Mr. President. We understood the request to be that as soon as there is an official scheduling order, we should give our views as to how long preparation time should be.
It's still unclear whether it is indeed
between 10-20 November or maybe even the first 2 weeks of December. I think that is now maybe debated at the Supreme Court chamber. Having said that, I do not think the request of the Khmer Pan team to ask for 5 weeks is unreasonable. As you know, the appeal is extensive. There's a lot of preparation to do. As you know, we've been fully busy with case 2-2. We've been flooded with case 3 and 4 documents. So we've been working, as argued last week, 2 weeks ago, almost non-stop. So, I would argue that the requested time is not unreasonable. But we haven't come up with a final position yet because, as I said, we understood your request to be that as soon as there is a scheduling order, we would then come up with our views.
ការពិភាក្សារាល់មតិយោបល់ទៅលើបញ្ហាដែលអង្គជំនះបានកំណត់ថាជាបញ្ហាប្រឈមចំពោះមុខអញ្ជើញលោកសាប្រេញា
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I was just waiting for to make some very brief comments on the submissions of the Khmer Sampan team. First, we would agree with the Nuen Chea team that it's premature at the moment to even talk about the time necessary to prepare appeal because we don't have neither a date from the Supreme Court nor an indication of the format, how many days hearings that will be, and whether the Supreme Court is going to limit the parties to specific issues to talk about, which I would hope that they would, because there's somewhere between 300 and 400 grounds of appeal. So we think it's premature to talk about time for preparation. As far as the time allotted to the expert on the CHAM, we do think 2 days is more than sufficient. But that's sufficient time. But I do concur with counsel's proposal that the chambers, it would be more efficient to have the expert testify at the end of the segment after the other witnesses. I think that makes sense.
បាទអរគុណហើយអរញ៉ៃយើងយកបញ្ហានេះយើងទៅពិភាក្សាយើងទៅសម្រេចដោះស្រាយលើបញ្ហានេះបញ្ហាដែលអាចចេញដោះស្រាយបានតាមតែអាចធ្វើទៅបានហើយបញ្ហាណាដែល ត្រូវទុកសិនបងអង្គទុកសិននោះគឺនឹងធ្វើតាមស្ថានភាពជាក់ស្ដែងនៃបញ្ហាចំពោះមុខបាទសម្រាប់ការនៅថ្ងៃនេះដល់ពេលជប់សម្រាប់ហើយអំពីប្រកាសផ្អាកកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្ណការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះត្រឹមនេះសម្ណការលើកបន្តធ្វើថ្ងៃច័ន្ទទី5ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ2015ចាប់ដើមពីម៉ោង6ព្រឹកសម្ណការនៅថ្ងៃច័ន្ទអង្គជំនះនឹងធ្វើសម្ណការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មសាក្សីដែលមានអត្តសញ្ញាណ
Just to be sure, no hearing tomorrow.
បាទអរគុណមិនមានអីទេមិនមានសកម្មភាពទេនៅក្នុងចុងសប្តាហ៍នេះព្រោះយើងអត់មានបុគ្គលដែលយើងត្រូវស្ដាប់លទ្ធភាពដែលអាចអញ្ជើញសកបុគ្គលដែលត្រូវស្ដាប់ហ្នឹងគឺមិនអាចធ្វើបានទេហើយបង្កប់ឲ្យនៅរយៈទីគុំខាំងនាំខ្លួនជនជាប់ចោតទាំងពីររូបនួនជានឹងខៀវសំផនត្រឡប់ទៅកាន់មន្ទីរគុំខាំងនៃអបតកវិញចុះនៅបង្កប់ឲ្យនាំខ្លួនគាត់ត្រឡប់ចូលរួមសកម្មភាពវិញនៅ ថ្ងៃច័ន្ទទី5ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ2015ឲ្យបានមុនម៉ោង9ព្រឹកសម្រាប់ចុះ